Welcome back to Transform Your Mind to Transform Your Life, the podcast. This is Life Coach Brene Young, and you're listening to Author's Corner, where we highlight and showcase local authors. Today, I'm speaking to Ptolemy Pruden, and he's the author of a book called China Rising. So what our topic is going to be today is the economics of war, and we're going to spend a lot of time talking about China. So welcome, Ptolemy.
Good morning. How are you doing, Myrna?
I am doing great. As I mentioned before we started recording, I don't know a lot about this topic. So let's see if I can contribute to the conversation. But anyway, it's a conversation that I thought that you guys need to hear. And that's why I brought Ptolemy on to talk about his book. So let me give you, set this up a little bit, give you an introduction to Ptolemy and also to the book China Rising. So Ptolemy Pruden, author of China Rising, The Case for Containment, and host of the Common Sense Defense podcast, discusses national security issues for the everyday person. That's me and that's you. All right. So over the past decade, the People's Republic of China has weaponized islands that claimed the South and then claimed the South China Sea as their own, cracked down on Hong Kong, taken away the freedom of millions of its citizens, imprisoned millions, denied Philippine fishermen access to their own fishing grounds, threatened Taiwan by running daily military drills near its airspace, blocked off rare earth from the U.S. market, sent a spy balloon over sensitive military bases, consistently stolen U.S. business information and intellectual property, raided U.S. companies in China, and failed to acknowledge their responsibility in the COVID-19 pandemic. Pass the blame, pass the buck. So let's start off by telling us the history and policies of China as it pertains to our conversation.
Okay, Myrna, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity for being to share with your audience. I think you have a very relevant topic today. And so I think what we want to accomplish is really just educating and talking to the everyday American about the importance of China and their expansion globally and how they impact our families and our children. And I think your podcast focuses really a lot on relationships and make sure relationships are strong with the marital relationship, parent to children. And I think this is a relationship that the individual family has with our nation so that we collectively can stay strong and stay out of war. I think inevitably the most important thing that we want to do is stay out of war. I think the Americans are tired of war. We've had war after war after war. And I think we're tired of war, but to accomplish being free from war, you have to have policies in place and capabilities in place so that people respect you, so they don't want to go and push your buttons and push you to where you were in conflict with them. And so China, which came into being from 1949, the People's Republic of China, they have grown amazingly over the last nearly 190 years to where they are today. And as they have gotten stronger, particularly since Xi Jinping has been in power in 2012, they have expanded the way that they want to influence the world from just being an economy that just grows, which we call a peaceful rise. We started communicating and trading with China for 20 years prior to that, and kind of built up their economy. And starting in 2012, when they entered into World Trade Organization, their economy just shot up big time because we opened up the environment for them to trade with us. But what happened, Myrna, was that they were building their economy, but that worked fine when they had the desire just to make their country strong for their moms and their dads and their kids, and wanted the economy strong. That was one component. But what happened was when Xi Jinping got in 2012, the dynamic changed. He says, wait a minute, we're not only we're going to be economically strong, we're going to take over as much as we can to be as strong as we can so that China itself is now the leader globally. And then he put together a policy that said by 2049, which would be 100 years from 1949, we will be the hyper, the biggest power globally, and we will be bigger than the United States. We will be the primary leader economically, technologically, militarily. And so he started on a path of consolidating power in China, firing people, putting people in jail, firing more people, putting more people in jail, putting whole societies in jail, like you mentioned about the Uyghur Muslims that were put in concentration camps and are still in concentration camps. So he started this process of nationalism that pushed forward a more aggressive China policy. And so therefore now that's what we're dealing with now, is we're dealing with a nation that has the second largest economy in the world, $17.4 trillion, and the largest naval platforms. And so they've just kind of grown. In addition to taking over the South China Sea, saying, hey, South China Sea is now ours. So the Philippines and all those countries on the littoral, whether all the way down from Singapore, all the way up to Japan, those countries are now in a situation where they're watching over their shoulder because China is coming their way.
Okay. That was a great introduction. Thank you for all that. But why do you think their policies, as far as economic policies, is going to transition somehow into war? Do you think that they're like a Putin that want to invade and take over countries, like including the U.S.? Mm-hmm. Where does that spin come from?
So I think there's a term where they want to have power, but not go to war. So if you can buy off your adversary, if you can, you know, let's look at Africa, for example. So they'll go in there and they buy a mine, and they build off a railroad system to extract the material from the mine. Very similar to the colonials done. I mean, the same concept, except right. They are funding the highways and funding the railroads for the stuff to go back to China. So they are providing infrastructure to bring back to China all of the natural resources. And the only way that, this is a little caveat, any way for any country to grow is to go from not only the manufacturing, bringing out of the ground the raw material, but also to produce something. When you become a producer, then you become a manufacturer, you can make money. But as long as you're taking all your natural resources and exporting them and not actually processing something to make a product, you will never be able to grow to that next level. So one is raw materials, the second one is processing, and then the other one is services. Those are different service sectors. And so Africa is still in that raw material phase where nothing is really being processed there. So China is taking that and exploiting the capability, and you only need the people who have owned the mines, whether they're the government or individual people. So what China does is they provide loans and provide the capital for the companies to extract raw material and then ship it back to China. So that what they have developed through the years is this term called BRI, the Belt Road Initiative. And the Belt Road Initiative is a way for China to put money into foreign countries to get influence with those countries. And so they get a win-win situation. They invest in those countries. They make sure they have constant raw materials and have a constant flow of traffic for trade. And then they process everything in China. China is the manufacturer of world's 33% of the world's production is made in China because they own the edge there. And so instead of having missiles and bullets, which you use currency. And so they've been using the currency to gain influence, to influence the world. And so there's nothing so much wrong with adding in funding projects. It's just the mindset and the policies behind it. It is the why. Why are you doing this? And so that's why I cite the Uyghurs. That's why I cite just 3 years ago, the kids, I call them kids because they're the ones protesting in Hong Kong. They no longer can protest. They have been taken over by mainland China. They have been taken over by the CCP, and they no longer have their freedom in Hong Kong. And so that's a process that constantly happens everywhere. The Uyghurs, 8 years ago, 9 years ago, were put in concentration camps, have been in concentration camps ever since. The Inner Mongolians, they have been told not to use their language anymore. They have to use a Han language. So what happens is a Hanification of the minorities in China. not, so that tells us what their mindset is. It's taking away the Philippine fishermen's rights and taking over the fishing grounds that they've been fishing in for hundreds of years, saying no longer can you fish here, only Chinese companies can fish here. So that mindset. And so that's before you start talking about bullets and missiles, that lets you know what kind of mindset you're dealing with. And also the failed policies of the one child policy from 1980 to 2016, over 300 million babies were, it's not about a pro-choice or pro-life issue. They just took the kids and forced sterilizations and forced abortions of these women who were just to this day emotionally damaged because they were forced by the government to lose their to take their children, to kill their children. And they mostly kill girls. That's why they have so many more boys now than girls. So that's a failed policy. So that's a mindset. So that's why I'm saying it's a series of failed policies, and the more influence they get, then they will influence the world globally.
Yeah. As you were talking, you know, I do have a little bit of input because I know that the, I've seen what you're talking about. One, I hear people talking about all the things that we're importing from China, and almost everything you purchase now is from China. It's, they have taken over as far as the economy with goods. So we got that. And I heard, you know, some politician, I'm not sure which, if it was Obama or Biden or Trump or somebody, was talking about how we are definitely importing more than we're exporting to China. And then we had the issue with TikTok, where they were saying that, you know, TikTok was a Chinese government way of spying on people. And then just this morning, I was reading something about Temu. I didn't even know that Temu was theirs, but Temu is an app that is so cheap that you would not believe it. And now they're saying that they're going after Amazon. So I think I understand what you're trying to say, that it's strategic to become a powerhouse and then just take over.
Yes.
Does that make sense to you? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, it's the ideology. And so the more you feed them, I think you mentioned the more that we trade with them, the more we feed them, the stronger they get and the more influence they have. And so if it looks like a duck, it smells like a duck and walks like a duck, then it's a duck. And I think that's kind of what we're looking at here. And we're like, oh, if we, for 20 years, 30 years, if we just keep giving them money and trade with them, then what's going to happen? They're going to say, oh, we want to be Democrats. We want to be, you know, and it didn't happen. Not only did it not happen, we have the converse of that, to the degree that not only do the Chinese control the citizens, they give them a social credit score, and they say, like, oh, you didn't do such and such right, so we're going to limit your ability to go to this city today. So they give them social credit scores so they control them. They have the DNA on all their citizens. They use retina scans and all these different things to the degree that where they're micromanaging the individual's life. So not even since Stalin's day has anybody's life been totally controlled like the Chinese totally control their life, from health and education, food, mobility. And so that's the mindset that we have to understand that we're dealing with, we're feeding. And the more powerful they'll get, the more influence they'll export to our friends and allies in the Western Pacific or in the Indo-Pacific area. So, and that's really what you're looking at. You're looking at check marks along the route to say, oh, I see they're doing this. Oh, I see they're doing this. So it lets you know what they are about. Not all the Chinese, it's just a few leaders, might be probably 10, 15 people running everything who are doing what Xi Jinping tells them to do. It's not that many people. It's maybe 10, 15 people doing everything. And so that's the mindset that we have to deal with. And the people themselves, I love the Chinese. Everybody loves the Chinese people, but it's the policies of the CCP that we're dealing with, that we have to deal with. It's kind of like Putin, right? I mean, we love the Russian people, the ones who are not hurting people, but our problem is that one man at the top, Putin, who's just amazingly crazy, right? So that's the thing that we're dealing with. And so, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Now I understand why your book is called China Rising. So it's very good, you know, project to have to educate people about this, because awareness is very important. So you mentioned something a minute ago about technology and retina scans, and it almost reminded me of the movie Eagle Eye, where they followed you everywhere.
Yes.
So how does technology and war go together? We're using this word war now, not missiles and bombs, but you know, the war for the mind or the war for whatever you want to call it. But yeah, how does technology influence us?
So do you know how when you forget your password and then you do a password reset and you send it, and then the second you send it out, it'll send a signal to your phone, I think it is, or something. Right. And you'll see that, and it gives you a little code, 4, 6, 8, 6 digit code. Okay. Right. That is how fast war is now. So when you see a target, it's called sensor to shooter. So technology is so fast now that you can not only detect it, you can also shoot that target in a millisecond. So technology now is so fast that you need men and women, you need men in the loop to say, okay, shoot this, shoot that. No, don't shoot that. Shoot that, shoot that. And that's how quick targets can tick away. And so technology now is so much faster than it was before. So now with that, you need computers to help you manage the resources of your military resources so that they work effectively. So because your adversary is doing the exact same thing. So he who has the fastest computer wins. And so that's when you start getting into machine learning, artificial intelligence, quantum computing. Those are the different tools that you need to make sure that your systems are going fast enough so that you can protect your men and women on the front lines.
Mm. So it's no longer going through where the person on the red phone has to press a number and it has to match someone else's, all that.
Yeah, girl, no, I'm sorry, my apologies. It's a different thing. Yeah, it's a different day now. It's faster, it's crazy. You know, you don't have to say, we have a target. And those days are totally over. It's like it's a prompt, it's quick, and you can give the computer authorization to launch automatically. So so when it sees a certain number of things coming through, it can defeat those targets automatically. And that's kind of one of the things we talk about through Common Sense Defense, is talking through what is that technological change like and how does it impact the everyday American citizen. So that's specifically to your point, talks about educating the everyday American about, you know, different types of weapons, different types of scenarios, policies and policymakers that we have to understand how to make sure our defense policies are strong. And so we deal specifically with that. And the other thing we also deal with through Common Sense Defense is economics, and how when you buy a refrigerator or a microwave or something that's made in China and it's a Chinese owned company, 25% of that cost goes to the CCP's budget. So everything that we buy, we have to realize that we're directly putting money into the Chinese budget. And so once we do that, then we realize, okay, let me stop buying. You don't stop buying everything, but some of the big ticket things, we need to go on a diet for what we buy so that they won't be as strong, so we don't have to worry about going to war with them 3 or 5 years from now.
That's good. That's a good idea. I know they were trying to push back because China was controlling almost all the imports. And I know they're trying to push back, but that's good but that's the government. This is good for the American people to understand this stuff. So I'm actually glad that I'm highlighting this and showcasing your book. So now let's talk about your book, China Rising. Tell us about why did you write it? I can see you're passionate about this topic, but what do you want readers to walk away with after reading?
So let me show you. This is a book here, actually. I don't know if I can show it or not, but that's the book. Yes, go ahead. Mm-hmm. 400 pages, China Rising. But the key with this is called The Case for Containment. And I think, you know, it's now that we have pushed up China to the point where economically we wanted them to be strong, and we do. But now that we're dealing with a situation where they have gotten so strong that, and we're recognizing, man, do we want these policies impacting us negatively and impacting our friends and allies in the Indo-Pacific? And I think so, protecting the Philippines, protecting Japan, protecting Australia, protecting people who are in the Indo-Pacific, India even, how do we protect our friends and allies so that they can live their life free and not be taken over by China's mindset, as what we were citing earlier about how they operate? And so I think that is the number one key, is how do we contain them? They say, oh, you're trying to contain us. Oh, you're trying. Yes, we are trying to contain you. Because you've proven that when you get power and when you get authority and a capability to do certain things, you abuse that, and you abuse everybody who's around you by your own desire. So that's what, if we have a say without going to war, we want to contain that so that we don't go to war. And so part of that is, what can our military do? What can the everyday American do? Like I just cited, everyday Americans can stop buying stuff made in China from Chinese-owned companies. Then we'll start seeing their GDP shrink and their GDP growth go from 3.5-4% to 2%. It needs to be somewhere in the 2% area so they can just focus on their developing their country and their people and not focusing on their military. I don't believe that. I believe they're going to spend as much money as they need on the military. But the point is, we want their economy to not be so robust so they have so much confidence to do whatever they want to do. Mm-hmm. And that gives you a little bit more sway for them not to want to go to war with you. The key is keeping them from wanting to go to war because it's not fiscally solid for them to do so. Okay, so when in the book, China Rise and Case for Containment, I lay out a plan on how we can work with our friends and allies in the Indo-Pacific and in Europe so that we can all pool our resources so that it won't be all too much on one country or one government. And so if we can pool our resources and our capabilities, and then we can have a bigger net effect. And so that's kind of really one of the things I talk about. And so that we can leverage our weapons, different types of weapons, missiles and submarines, and leverage certain types of weapons so that they are used in a way that that it proposes a deterrent to China. And the second thing I talk about is the use of not decommissioning ships and in making the ships that we have more lethal, putting missiles on surface ships like landing craft, putting surface-to-surface missiles on them so that they can be effective to sink a Chinese ship. And we don't have to be in a situation where we have less ships than they do, because we currently do. We have about 290 ships. They have 500, close to 400 ships now. And so they're looking at how do we leverage our own capabilities and make our platforms more lethal so that they are able to pose more of a threat to China. And so I look at different chapters of the book, we look through different iterations of a collaboration, different iterations of technological rolling out, different types of technologies so that we can have a stronger deterrent against China.
Nice. Very good. Yes, you know, I am listening to you and I recognize that you are very intelligent and you know a lot about politics. I'm wondering why you're not on Biden's team or something.
I'm reaching out to the. That's funny. I'm reaching out to their team in the next week or so before they do the presidential budget. And so we reach out to Congress now. We're working with Congress actually now for $15 billion for ships and stuff. So it's funny you'd say this. So
I'm listening to you and I'm thinking, wow, this guy is great. So listen, I'm very glad that I was able to, you know, highlight and showcase your book. I got a lot out of this interview. And I'm pretty sure that the people that are listening, this is new information to them. So thank you so much for your passion, for writing the book, for coming on the show, for your podcast. You know, you're in this space and, you know, everybody has goals and of service. And your goal is to educate the ordinary people on national defense and China and paying attention to them because, yes, you know, there's a silent enemy and there's a silent killer and all these things. And whatever you ignore, right, then when it happens, then you say, you know what, I didn't know this was coming. So, hey, this is definitely a way to bring our awareness to it. So thank you so much, Ptolemy, for coming on the show. How can people pick up a copy of your book? Tell us about your social media handles if you're on social media.
Sure. They can go to commonsensedefensepodcast.com. Just over my shoulder is a QR code, commonsensedefensepodcast.com. They can, and that will let them go to information on being subscribers to Common Sense Defense Podcast. And also that will take them directly to the book page as well. And so the book is called China Rising, the Case for Containment. And so they can go there. We do have a YouTube page with called Common Sense Defense Podcast as well. So you can plug in Common Sense Defense Podcast and there's a litany of things in that you can go through to our different social media tags.
Awesome. All right, guys. Well, I'm excited about this interview. I'm excited to bring you these great authors that need need highlighting and showcasing so that, you know, somebody sits down and writes a book and they want people to read it. So that's why I facilitated Authors Corner. So Thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you, Ptolemy, for being on the show. Go out and pick up a copy of Ptolemy's book and subscribe to his podcast. If anything that he's talking about interests you, if you are, you know, into the space of politics and into the space of understanding defense, or you're a political science student and you want to understand all this stuff, I can tell that he is a wealth of information. So tap his resources and support him in his journey to make this information accessible to, you know, not just somebody that's on the Congress defense team, but all of us. All right. So thank you for tuning in. Thank you, Ptolemy. Before we wrap up, any last words?
No, I just appreciate the space. And yes, that is what we're trying to reach out to, is everyday American people going after being a change to change our policies so that we have a strong defense. And so we really appreciate that. And we really appreciate your team reaching out and to Common Sense Defense as well podcast.
Okay. All right. Thank you, guys. So until next time, namaste.